gathered here this afternoon in the presence of God and before this congregation to join together Sarah and David in marriage. And since the beginning of creation, in his gracious purpose, God provided marriage as the acceptable way in which a man and a woman may come together as husband and wife. This is the only basis on which Christian marriage can take place within the church. This issue of marriage is not determined by public opinion or personal preference or prejudice, but it is determined by God himself, the creator of all of us. Marriage is a holy estate instituted by God and hallowed by our Lord's gracious presence at the marriage in Cana of Galilee. It is commended in the Bible as honourable, and it is consecrated as signifying the mystical union between Christ and his church. Marriage, therefore, is not to be entered upon lightly or unadvisedly, but thoughtfully, reverently, in the fear of God, with the due consideration of the ends for which it was ordained. It was ordained for the lifelong companionship, help and comfort that husband and wife ought to have of each other. It was ordained for the continuance of the holy ordinance of family life, that children who are the heritage of the Lord should be duly trained and nurtured in godliness. And thirdly, it was ordained for the welfare of human society, which can only be strong and happy when the marriage bond is held in honour. Into this holy estate, Sarah and David now desire to enter. A license and certificate has been given. There has been no impediment alleged by them or against them, and therefore we are in a position to go ahead with the marriage this afternoon. Let us unite together in prayer. Well, Lord our God, we come this afternoon and we thank you for the opportunity of gathering with family and friends on this very special occasion in the life of Sarah and David. And we come and we thank you for all the influences of the past that have been brought to bear upon their lives, that have molded their characters and brought them to this place and made them the people that they are. And as we do come today, we come and we thank you for all the gifts that you give to us each day, for our health and strength, for the ability to be here today, for our food and our clothing, when so many in our world have so little, for our friends and our families, when there are those who have no one to look after them and who simply are destitute and lonely and helpless. And as we come today also thanking you for these material blessings, we come also and we thank you for the spiritual benefits that can be available to us through our recognition of your love for us in Jesus Christ. We thank you that he came into the world to die on the cross in order that we could have our sins forgiven and that one day that we would all be present at the great marriage feast above. Help us, our Father, as we gather just now, to acknowledge your goodness to us and to seek to walk in your ways. And as we come today, we thank you for the institution of marriage, which you have ordained to guard and to hallow and to perfect the sacred gift of love. We thank you for the joy that Sarah and David have found in one another and for the trust into which they enter the estate of marriage. And since without your help we cannot do anything as we should, we pray that you will enrich them with your grace and that they may enter into the marriage covenant as in your sight and truly keep the vows that they're about to make through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Would the congregation please stand? Who gives this woman to be married to this man?
I do.
Sarah and David, as a seal of the vows you're about to make, give to each other the right hand. I, David, do take you, Sarah,
To be my wedded wife,
to be my wedded wife, and do in the presence of God,
and do in the presence of God,
and before this congregation,
and before this congregation,
promise and covenant,
promise and covenant,
to be a loving,
to be a loving,
faithful,
faithful,
and loyal husband to you,
and loyal husband to you,
until God shall separate us by death,
until God shall separate us by death.
I, Sara.
I, Sara.
Do take you, David.
Do take you, David.
To be my wedded husband.
To be my wedded husband.
And do in the presence of God.
And do in the presence of God.
And before this congregation.
And before this congregation.
Promise and covenant.
Promise and covenant.
To be a loving.
To be a loving.
Faithful.
Faithful.
And loyal wife to you.
And loyal wife to you.
Until God shall separate us by death.
Until God shall separate us by death.
As a token of the covenant into which you have entered, these rings are given and received. By this sign, we take each other to have and to hold from this day forward, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health, to love and to cherish, till death do you part. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. Would the congregation please be seated. Now we're going to have a reading that's going to be read to us by Kevin.
This reading is taken from 1 Corinthians chapter 13. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am only a resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have a faith that can move mountains but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flames but have not love, I give nothing. Love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud. It is not rude, it is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Love never fails. But where there are prophecies, they will cease. Where there are tongues, they will be stilled. Where there is knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part and we prophesy in part. But when perfection comes, the imperfect disappears. When I was a child, I talked like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I put childish ways behind me. Now we see but a poor reflection as in a mirror. Then we shall see face to face. Now I know in part. Then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known. And now these three remain, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love.
Thanks very much, Lady. Sara and David, may I be the first this afternoon to congratulate you on your marriage here today and to trust that you'll have a very long and happy marriage. We've already said that we'll have a good day today, but that you will have a great time together throughout the remainder of your life.
Say the least, but the little scare to welcome you all to Sara and David's wedding. I'd like to welcome David into the Magaloni family and he's buried a good son-in-law or else. Folks will be after him, or far worse, the boss, per ma, and trust me, I know. It doesn't seem like a year since I was speaking at Kathy's wedding last August. Some of you were at her wedding, so it's a pity I can't use the same speech and save myself a bit of time. Anyway, here goes. I would like to thank you all for coming to Sara and David's wedding and for the Reverend Dr. Ian McLean for conducting the lovely service first class. I would also like to thank my sisters Jean and Donald for travelling from London and Dublin to be here today. Also, you are all going to get the wedding cake baked by Mary Berry, a.k.a. Ellen. So I'd like to thank you to Sara's Aunt Ellen. Sara wants to speak to you in a bit in this speech about your uncle Trevor. Trevor, are you listening down there? Now, she hopes her solar panel is doing the job. They know what we're on about, and if anyone wants to know about the solar panel, come and ask me at no charge. I would also like to say something about Sara. She thinks she's getting off late, but she's not. Sara was once a wee doll runner about Eastbourne Avenue with blonde pigtails. Now she's a big blonde doll running around with her hair extensions. That's the two daughters from Hitch now, time to party. And that's it.
Welcome friends and relatives. On behalf of Lorna and myself, I would like to thank you all for coming here today to celebrate this, the most special day of our son's life. It seems like yesterday that he was born with blown sticks in his hair. My brother Aidan will remember helping me with some work at the house when David was 3 years old. And the only thing that David wanted to do was hammer on nails with Uncle Ivan. His great Aunt Emma looked after him every Thursday. And some of those days she took him and his buggy to pick strawberries over Montgomery's and Barton Gardens. And it was funny on a Sunday when they drove past, the entrance all we could hear from the back seat was him saying, "No, Lake Gomery." Enough said, David, I don't want to embarrass you. That's Jordan's job there. You've grown into a great man with some great qualities, one being a good judge of character, and you've put this today in the choice of Sara and your wife. Sara, Lorna and I, Jordan and Joanna welcome you into our family with open arms. You're a lovely girl and we love you dearly and we're proud to have you as our daughter-in-law. To both of you, we wish you a long and wonderful life together. So ladies and gentlemen, raise your glasses and join us in a toast to our son David and our daughter-in-law Sara, wishing them a lifetime of happiness and love. David and Sara.
Thank you, Dad and Desi, for your kind words. On behalf of my wife and I, I'd like to start by thanking everyone for coming today and for your generous gifts and well wishes. They're all greatly appreciated. To all the people that have helped make this day happen, to Lindsay for making our invitations, to Ellen for making our beautiful wedding cake and macaroons for the evening buffet, to Karen and Janice for their hard work baking shortbread and tray bakes. I'm looking forward to sampling those later, so no pressure, girls. To the Reverend McNee for conducting a lovely wedding service. Thank you very much. I would also like to thank my lifelong friend Jenny for her lovely reading today. We all really appreciate you coming home to be part of our special day. Also a big thank you to my Nana and Granda for their use of their garden earlier for photos. It looked amazing as usual, and for the refreshments that you provided for everyone that was there. Sara and I would especially like to thank our parents for their emotional and financial support in making this the perfect day. I'd like to thank Desi and Joe for welcoming me into their family. I've always been made feel very welcome from the first time I was in their home. And to my own parents, Mervyn and Lorna, thank you for making me the person I am today. I love you both. And to my little sister, Joanna, for getting out of bed today before 11 o'clock. Much appreciated. But seriously, I know how much you're looking forward to having Sara as a big sister. We both love you lots. To the groomsmen, Gavin and Andrew, we'd both like to thank you for doing a great job today. Thanks, guys. And we'd also like to thank the ushers, Neil and Robin, for getting everyone to where they should be. Thank you, lads. And to the bridesmaids, you all look absolutely beautiful today. You've all done a brilliant job in making this wedding special, from organising the hen do to where we are today. So thank you, ladies, for all that you have done. So if we could all raise our glasses and a toast to the bridesmaids. Now on to the best man, Jordan. Well, what can I say? You've been my rock and support during the lead up to the big day. Thanks for organising the great stag do in Belfast and for everything else that you've done. You've not only been the best man today, in my eyes, you're the best man every day. The best brother anyone could wish for, and you truly are my best friend, so cheers, bro. And now, to the star of the show, my beautiful wife, Sara, who is looking absolutely stunning, should I say so myself. I must take this opportunity to thank our friends, Ronan and Natalie, for setting up that blind date nearly 5 years ago. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here today. Sara, you are the most kind and caring and loving person that I know, and I'm blessed to have you in my life. You're a credit to your parents for the woman you are today. So thank you for becoming my wife, and I can't wait to spend the rest of my life with you. I love you.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I hope that everyone is enjoying this very special day so far. I would like to introduce myself for those who don't know me. I am Jordan, the groom's brother, the best at everything, or I mean the best man. First of all, I've just got one wee message I would like to read out. It goes as, Dear Sara and David, sending love and best wishes to you as you celebrate your love on this your wedding day. I'm so sorry I can't be with you and your family and friends, and of course your mums and dads, but us super grands can't be everywhere, and I'm 6,000 miles away. David, we've known you from we came into this world, and I have to be honest to say you were simply a torture for years. Oh, and years now I come to think about it. But honestly, I think that Sara will deal with this perfectly well in many ways. You've met your match. But hey, just look at you now, you're a fantastic guy who has met a fantastic lady, and I'm so very happy for you both. Marriage is simple, David and Sara. If you remember to take care of each other's hearts and minds, respect each other with honesty and look after each other always, God bless you both. I'll be keeping an eye, a phone on you all today. I wish everyone a fabulous day. Love from your own next door, Aunt Iris. Go, I'm the 20s. And just before I get, folks, before I start my speech, management spoke to me earlier on the interest of health and safety. No one is to stand on the tables or chairs during my standard ovation at the end. Firstly, I would like to thank David for his kind words about the bridesmaids, who are, of course, looking fantastic today, and Sarah. I can't imagine any bride has ever looked any more beautiful than you do today. I think the room will agree that David is punching well above his weight. The first time I met Sara, I knew David had got himself a good one here. She is a great girl, and I am delighted to have her as my sister-in-law. And David, you don't scrub up too bad either. The only thing is, I'm not too impressed you went and caught me right fit today. I am lucky to be here to see this day because when I was a baby, David lifted me out of the cot and left me lying on the landing at the top of the stairs and went outside to herd cows that had broken into the front garden. It's a pity he wasn't as fussy about Iris and Gordon's garden. For him and Jenny had a great time knocking all the heads of the plants with two badminton rackets. So Sara, you watch out and we'll be careful ours. As a wee boy, David had a language of his own. Where you and I would have a sore throat, David would have a pain in his elastic cut. Where we would study religious education, David studies religious seduction. Nana and Granda were known as Dug a Dang and Nana Boo Boo. Our neighbours, Rosie and Willie, were known as Romy and Romy Too. The only thing I understood was when I heard him say, "Your pants," and funny enough, that was said a few times this morning before I left. Sarah, when the time comes for a family, David has the perfect sized child seat. You see, he was personally awarded the Clonmore Primary School Naughty Chair because I get the most use out of it. Oh, and David, if you're passing through the nursery, the long wooden block that you threw onto the roof is still there. I don't think Miss Irene has ever got over the shock, or Mum come to think of it. Two members of staff and three nursery children had a close call that day. But on a more serious note, David, you have been a great brother to me and Joanna, someone we both look up to and we are proud to call our big bro. We will miss you not being around as much as usual. You have now found your soulmate in Sarah, and as you both start out on a whole new adventure as husband and wife, I want to wish you both a lifetime of love, laughter, and happy ever after. So ladies and gentlemen, would you all stand and raise your glasses to toast to the bride and groom, Sarah and David. That's me, folks. Thank you.
Red roses too, I see them bloom for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, "How do you do?" They're really saying, "I love you." I hear babies cry. I watch them grow. They're like much more. I never knew, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.